Got to be careful where you put this thing. So good morning, Unity of Birmingham. In spite of the way I'm dressed, I'm still Reverend Charles, for those of you who are new here. And I'm the senior minister here at Unity of Birmingham. So we're celebrating Halloween with our youth today. And you know, we told folks it was okay if you came in costume. And got to lead by example, right? Actually, I had a lot of fun picking this costume out. About 3 weeks ago, I was on vacation up in West Virginia with a lot of my former theater classmates, people that I went to West Virginia University with, where I got my undergraduate degree. And we had a reunion, and at one point, several of us took off. Basically, we were out looking for West Virginia souvenirs, and one of the stores that we went to, right next to it, was one of those big Halloween stores. So we went in and picked out stuff for Halloween. And actually, of all of the Avengers, I really kind of identify least with Thor, and maybe I need to look at that. You know? Iron Man and Captain America are the two that I probably feel the closest to, but both of them have stuff on their face, and I couldn't really talk to you today with something over my face, so Thor it is. But as I hope, get to, maybe there's something for me to learn from this guy too, because each of those characters actually represents something in consciousness. These past several weeks, we have been talking about the evolution of consciousness. And if you've been with us, you know, the past couple of weeks, first we talked about where we are in consciousness, asking that question kind of on that larger map of the development of consciousness, where am I? How far have I gotten? You know, so that we can then say, okay, so now where do I need to head out to? And last week, we talked about who am I? Because if we don't know who we are to begin with, if we don't become aware of who we are, we have really no way of knowing, again, where we need to get to if we wish to develop, evolve in consciousness. So this week we're going to take that second question a little deeper in terms of who we are. And in a way, I want to begin by answering the question. And who we are is complete. We are complete. And that is something that so many of us struggle our entire lives and never fully understand. If we know that, then we have the opportunity to begin the work in consciousness of finding those areas that we have hidden. We may think that they are lost to us, but no piece of us can ever be completely and truly lost. We may have buried some things very, very deeply, but they're still there. And when we do the work that is ours to do in consciousness, we can find those pieces of us, we can become whole, and we can truly enable ourselves to journey towards oneness with spirit. Kind of the final journey that we as souls make is that journey back to God. You may not have known that I'm a geek. Maybe obvious by now. But as I was doing some studying last night, I was also, you know, taking a few breaks. And at one point, I found on Facebook where some other geek had taken all of the Star Wars trailers for the new Star Wars that's coming out in Christmas, and they had re-edited them together to kind of tell the chronological story of everything we know. And it was pretty cool. So after I watch it, I realize I'm stirred up. My emotions have been touched. And I ask myself, it's like, how does this do this to me? You know, how do I get so emotional and so caught up in something like this? And it came to me, kind of like a thunderbolt. Yeah. It's because they are going through exactly what we are going through. And it doesn't matter if they're a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, or in a complete fantasy world, in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. What all of these great characters in these stories that reach out and touch us are doing is essentially finding that lost part of themselves, just like we are called to do. And, you know, if you remember this in Star Wars, Luke starts out with a part of himself that's been buried very deeply. He has the Force very strong within him. He is a Jedi. But he's a farm kid on a desert planet. And it's his journey back to finding who he truly is that is his story. For those of us who are familiar with Joseph Campbell, you know, he studied what he calls the monomyth, which is essentially the same story arc that has been told hundreds and hundreds, maybe thousands of times, throughout different cultures from the dawn of time to movies that are still in production today. And that is the story of a hero who is somehow separated from God himself, his culture, whatever it might be, the story of his separation and then his isolation and his growth and his journey back until he is reunited as something different and something more than he or she was to begin with. It's the story of all of us. It's the story of humanity. If we look at the myth that begins in Genesis chapter 1, where humanity falls from grace. In that moment, in that taste of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the moment we become aware that, or at least we think we're aware, that it's not simply all that is, that we can now judge it as either being good or evil, we have separated ourselves from it. The moment we step outside and begin judging, we are no longer a part of what it is. And all of man's journey, everything all of us are doing, everything we've all done since that moment that we became judges, is an effort to find our way back home, to find our way back into the Garden of Eden, that place, you know, where, is it Rumi or Hafiz, it says there's a place, there's a field where there is no right, there is no wrong, I'll meet you there. That's the Garden of Eden. There is no right, there is no wrong, there simply is. This is a dynamic universe, and we apply labels to so many things, we judge so many things. We look at what we call natural disasters, and even the word disaster is a label that we apply to an event, which is simply the result of the natural forces at work on this planet, whether they are wind or wave or the earth shaking under our feet. We can say they're acts of God because, well, it relieves the insurance companies a little. But in truth, everything that happens in the universe is an act of God. This is all an act of God. We are an act of God. And it is up to us to stop condemning pieces of ourself so that we can bring them back into alignment with who we truly are. What we're talking about is doing work that we define as shadow work. And a lot of people have heard about the shadow. And many of us tend to think that, well, all of my bad impulses are in the shadow, right? But the truth about the shadow is this: it contains all of those parts of our personality, all of those parts of our divine essence that at some point in our life we decided made us unsafe, did not help us cope in this world. So we took those pieces of us and we shoved them into the shadow. And they can be very different things for very different people. I told the story last week about a friend of mine who attempted to shove his sexuality into the shadow and about what happened to him as a result. But so many of us have taken pieces of our emotions and shoved them into the shadow. I know that like many people who grew up in the kind of home I grew up in, one with a lot of conflict, I was not safe displaying my anger. So my anger got shoved into the shadow. And portions of it are still there today. And I get to deal with them. That's how I identify with the Hulk. Right? He's a big green anger monster who does a pretty good job of keeping his stuff in the shadow most of the time. You know, and then he lets it out. So many of these characters that we see represent some portion of our shadow life. And in fact, Robert Brummett, in the book that we've been studying and that I've been using for my talks on Sunday for these past few weeks, in Birthing a Greater Reality, talks about some of those elements. He talks about sub-personalities. And we have a lot of different sub-personalities. You know I do. Some of mine even have different names, right? Like from back when I was you know, kind of a cool party animal, and everybody called me CP. Some people still do. They've known me for 30, 40 years. Like my sister still calls me CP. Some people call me Charles. Some people call me Reverend Charles. Some people call me Chief. Each one of those is kind of comes with some different stuff, right? But there are a lot of different personalities. Robert talks in there about, for example, and many of you may identify with this. He says, you may have a sub-personality that as you're walking by the donut shop tells you, you really deserve one of those donuts, you know? And your life is simply not gonna be complete until you go inside and have one. And then after you're finished with it, you're going to have another sub-personality tell you that you absolutely should not have had that donut. You are guilty and you are going to be a big fatty, right? A lot of us can identify with that. And, you know, I could give a name to both of those sub-personalities. They're Mom, right? You know, I can remember my mother. That, you know, a couple of examples of where this comes from. When you ask, well, where do these things come from, right? They come from the way that we grew up. I remember when I was in college, my mother was already worried about how much I drank, right? And so she's telling me, you know, Charles, you know, you gotta be careful with that. Oh, and here, I made you some spicy tomato juice for your Bloody Marys. I'm not making this up, okay? Later in life, I'm in my 30s, and you know, I've gained some baby weight, right? And my, you know, X2, my second wife, right? X2. I guess just to keep the name straight, I just number them, from, you know, now. But anyway, X2 was from Birmingham, Alabama, and that girl could cook, right? So I was as heavy as I've ever been. Go up to South Carolina and visit my mother, and one of the first things she said was, wow, Charles, you put on some weight. The very next thing out of her mouth is, I've got a Texas sheet cake on the counter in there. Thanks, Mom. Mixed message, much? So we wonder where we get these things from, you know? We get them from Mom, we get them from Dad. We get them from the people who formed us. We get them from whatever it was it took for us to survive those people. Whatever it took to be normal, whatever that is for us. You know, I go back again to, like say, a relationship with food. And like on one hand, there was always time spent with my grandmother or my mother, and very often that was time in the kitchen. And so it was a time of love. And I know that I sort of equated food with love, right? And then later on, when I was in junior high school, my dad had a deal with my sister and I that if we were on the honor roll, you know, like when our report cards came out, that he would take us out to dinner by ourselves, just me and dad. Well, at that point, my dad and my mother were separated and then eventually got divorced. So that was, you know, one of the few times I'd get to see my dad. So I began to equate approval with food, right? So not a really healthy combination. It's very easy to begin to say, oh, this is what this is, and shove all the rest of it into the background. So when we ask ourselves, how do I know if I have an unhealthy attachment to something, or how do I know I have taken a part of me and shoved it into the shadow? How do I know? One of the biggest answers that we have is projection. It's interesting. We actually have a projection room here in the church. That's where Barry sits during the service. Kind of, it's funny that it actually is labeled on the door. It says projection room. Okay, I need to be in there today. How do we know when we're projecting? Well, there are a few really easy ways to tell. Number one is if you have a disproportionate emotional response to something. You know, somebody makes a remark and it just gets under your skin immediately. Maybe you lash back at them. It just doesn't seem, and at the end of it, it's like, wow, where did that come from? Right? Ever happen? Chances are, whatever that was about, could have been about a lot of things, but whatever the root issue of that was, might very well be something that you have in the shadow. Now, in addition to being disproportionate, if something is chronic, if you tend to have an ongoing issue with a particular thing or a person, you just can't quite seem to get over it, that's a good sign that whatever they're bringing up for you, that, you know, you're only seeing the tip of the iceberg with that. There's more of that stuff down in your shadow, and it's time to go in there and take a look at it. The other thing is if you are a little obsessive emotionally, either with a particular person or a particular thing. That'll let you know that, hey, that person or that thing in some way or another represents some part of me that I have buried down in the shadow. And I would really like to have that out pictured in my life. What can I do to bring that into my life? What we do is we want to go reach out and put them in our life, when instead we could reach in and draw forth that part of us that they represent to us. You know, I think at some level when I first met Christine, she represented to me a part of me that was down in there, but it was kind of buried. And she was a very bright light. And I think that what I did was I pursued her instead of pursuing my light. So it's interesting how the universe balances things out and gives us the opportunities we need to do the work we're called to do. Amen? Yeah. So much of shadow work is forgiveness. You know, when we start taking a look deep inside, so much of what it is that we are called to do is forgive. And let me frame forgiveness for this particular discussion. Forgiveness is not saying it's okay what you did, right? That's not what we're talking about here. For these purposes, when I say forgiveness, what I'm talking about is our ability to control our own response. We have the responsibility which I know this is spelled differently, but the ability to respond in a different way. Now, if at some point in the past you were harmed by someone or something, it's very possible that somebody told you you need to be a big girl or a big boy and get over it. And so your emotional response to that wounding was shoved into your shadow along with everything else. It's okay to pull that out and do the work that you need to do. If you have to grieve over that, it's okay. But doing grief work means we're going to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, not build a condo in it, right? We don't ignore it. You know, we don't ignore it, but we don't hang out in it. We don't make that our new identity, right? We find those things that are touching us. And again, by following projections into our shadow is one of the ways we can do that. We find those things. We feel the feelings. We allow ourselves to have those feelings that we have about them, have the feelings, get them over with, and then use our ability to respond in a different way. We do not let the past hold us hostage. We put our past behind us. We honor it, we feel it, and we free ourselves from it. Because once we've done that, we can take those pieces of us that we've hidden in the shadow and bring them into the light and say, yes, now that can be a healthy part of me. I take a look at these characters, right? And if you have seen any of the Marvel movies, one of the things that happens to Thor in the movie, that's the first movie about him, is that he is banished to Earth. He has a huge ego. And he is sent to Earth without his powers, without his hammer. Well, his hammer goes to Earth, but he's not allowed to pick it up, which really upsets him. And he's forced to learn humility because he is supposed to eventually be a king. But it's not enough to be able to destroy your enemies. You have to know that you have to serve the people around you. You have to live for them. You have to be willing, to die for them, which at the end of that movie is what makes him worthy of picking up the hammer. Captain America, who had the soul of a warrior, was sent into the earth with the body of a weakling. And he too proved his worth by finally being willing to lay down his life for the people around him. Just as those characters tell a story of moving from their incompleteness to their completeness, so we tell our own stories. But the key lies in our shadow, the plot line, the villains and the heroes. They are deep within us. I am complete. Affirm that with me. I am complete. One more time. I am complete. Please join me in prayer. Sweet Spirit, in this moment, on this day, as we look deeply within ourselves, we know that you are there. All that we have ever needed is there. All that we will ever need for all that lies ahead of us simply awaits our coming home to who we truly are. In this season, when we wear masks, we become something else. We remember that it's okay to drop the masks we thought we needed growing up. It's okay to be who we truly are. It's okay to be all that we are, all that we were ever meant to be. We're safe. We are loved. We are home. So it is.